In this edition of Impact, we follow a 65-year-old fitness competitor whose muscled body is the result of a painful past.
You only have one life, one time to do it. Try to do it right. That's the way I feel about it.
But first, we meet some men who show us that being a drag queen isn't just about glitz and glamour.
You can be something new. You can be your own creation. And that's what I love about it.
Welcome to Impact. I'm Shweta Saraswat, this year's supervising producer. This episode takes us to Las Vegas, a place where dreams and determination take center stage. In our first segment, we go beyond the wigs and the makeup and into the world of drag queens. These men are often stigmatized for their lifestyles, but they find solace in dressing as women.
Drag queens are like glamorous clowns. They're like modern age court jesters.
It's often has a kind of power to it, you know, sort of magic.
I originally did it because it just looked like fun.
I started with doing a talent show, and then I entered a few contests.
Like, it was sort of like shocking to like look in the mirror and be like, oh my God, I look amazing. It's kind of like learning how to paint, like a picture. It's like art class, but on your face. The way I like to think of it is that I kind of take the face down to mute by blocking out my eyebrows with the special effects putty and then just putting like foundation all over, and then I've got like a blank canvas. And then I use different makeup colors like highlights and contours to paint on the bone structure of a girl. I've never thought of what I do or anything about me as being odd or different or strange. But I guess from the outside looking in, especially more conservative people, might not understand it at all.
There's a very long history of cross-dressing in entertainment. It goes back, in fact, millennia. It's one of the oldest forms of sort of ritual humor in human societies.
Shane's craft is singing. He went from performing in dark nightclubs to lighting up national television when he was discovered on Australian Idol.
I auditioned for the first season of Australian Idol. I went along the first day as myself, Shane, and I got knocked back, so I went back the next day in drag as Courtney, and I made it through to the finals. And Australian Idol definitely was validation that I could have a legitimate career as an entertainer. So many people moved to LA with sort of hopes and dreams of becoming famous or of fulfilling their dreams, and so I'm kind of like one of those people, but I just happened to do it in clothing of the opposite gender. Drag, I don't think, is just about being a woman. It's about creating whatever you want. This, the fact that there's absolutely no rules.
But Courtney Act may have an expiration date.
10 years from now, I will be 40, and I hope that I'm not doing drag, only because I'm bound to hit puberty eventually, and then Courtney won't look so pretty. So I would hope that over the next 10 years, have like a live show, maybe in Vegas, like a band and dances and costumes.
300 miles away, in a city that is known for its big spenders and risque nightlife, a troupe of female impersonators have made the Las Vegas Strip their stage.
Gosh, I'm looking for a really nice coral or orange or tangerine for my high cheekbones. I think that's gonna do the trick. This one and this one, yeah. Oh my gosh, this is so high. I don't get to go to the ball. I can't dance in this for sure.
Oh!
I think with my body size, maybe the nine.
The nine.
The nine.
The nine will be perfect, yes.
The nine will be fabulous. Mm. Only if they came in chocolate, chocolate color. I've always been fascinated with makeup. Just seeing the transformations from a guy to a female, different skin tones,
high cheekbones, to make your eyes look larger by adding colors. I really, really enjoyed the makeup part of the drag. My family at first thought it was a little bit over the top and outrageous to do something like that. It took a while for my father to adjust to it because I'm the only son. It upset him at first, and then he realized that my son is always be my son no matter whether he's gay, straight, or whatever, or if he's dressing as a female. And I would always remember, he says, "I'm proud of you, son." And just, as of today, it's just very, very touching.
Larry Edwards has been impersonating Tina Turner for almost 30 years. And as one of the performers in the strip's hit show, Divas Las Vegas.
I've always admired Tina Turner, even when I was a kid. Her music is just fascinating to me. I love, love, love her music and the way she dances and her shimmy and her look.
You just can't see, okay? Bye.
I want to bring a woman out I think's gonna blow the roof right off the place. She had one of the biggest comebacks ever in musical history. She's the original Proud Mary. Let's welcome Tina Turner.
I call you, I need you, my heart's on fire. You come to me.
Just to see the joy on their faces makes me feel so good inside to know that I made a person happy.
Divas Las Vegas was created by Frank Marino, a Las Vegas legend who famously impersonates Joan Rivers.
It'll be 30 years. I've been performing on Las Vegas Strip. First started, I was 17 years old, and I started doing it at local nightclubs, and then when I was 19, got the job being the star of this big Las Vegas show, which was really like unheard of, but for me, a fantastic thing. I was very lucky that my whole family is very supportive of what I choose to do in life, and at first my parents were a little leery that I was originally wanting to be a doctor, and then I say I want to be the star of a drag show. Until my mother realized she doubled her wardrobe, and now she's fine with it.
Divas Las Vegas runs 6 nights a week, and more than 10 million people have seen Frank perform.
I think America is fascinated with it, and you can't really see it everywhere. So when you come to Las Vegas, you know it's a mecca that does have, you know, a drag show in it. For that reason, I think we get all these people coming in, and it's like a guilty pleasure type thing. The way I got my job, I was in Joan Rivers' dressing room in Atlantic City. I just went backstage to tell her that I was an impersonator of her. And while I was in her dressing room, I met the producers of a drag show in Atlantic City that was opening a show in Las Vegas and asked me to audition for it. So I could actually say Joan Rivers got me my job.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the star of our show as Joan Rivers, Frank Marino!
People in drag can say things that they might not be able to say out of costume. And you can often say things with a smile that people wouldn't, you know, be able to hear if they were said in a serious context.
Next time I travel, I'm going in drag. Could you imagine? Yeah. Because here's how it's going to go. You know, sometimes they get very nasty at TSA. So it'll be like, step in the booth. I'll be like, okay. Then the thing spins around, you got that pervert going, ooh, those eyes, those thighs, and all of a sudden, whoa, surprise!
A good drag performer to me is somebody that not only could lip sync well, do makeup well, and look like the character they're doing, but feel the inner spirit of the character they're doing, and be a great performer. A lot of people could look like somebody, but if you can't perform, it really makes no sense to bother even doing it. I see people in drag make everything from $25 a night to something like myself. My last contract when I was just an employee was a 10-year, $10 million contract, plus
product sales. So the realm goes from poverty to extremely rich, I guess you'd say.
T-shirt, cookbook, DVD.
It's such a tough career, and people are very cruel and very mean, and it's a blow to your ego because the product is you. My advice to somebody 18 years old getting into the business would be, don't let anybody tell you you can't do it. Just keep, if you know you can do it and you have that feeling, just keep going for it. Nobody has the right to decide your destiny except yourself.
Determining his own destiny is exactly what one 18-year-old drag queen is doing. To set himself apart from his competition, he designs and sews his own costumes.
A part of me has always hated wearing something that other people have. I've always liked even taking clothes that I've bought and like embellishing them in some way or changing them or altering them or just making them even fit me a little better. And so like when I go out in drag, I never really wear things off the shelf, like something you can buy in a store. I like creating something that people haven't seen before. I didn't perform for my first time until I was 17. I thought I looked so fantastic because like I'd never done it before, and I was like, oh my God, I look so pretty. And it just felt kind of amazing to just go out and do. A lot of people I know who do drag, myself included, don't feel that confident or whatever out of drag. Like they don't feel like they're the most attractive or whatever, what have you. So putting on, I guess, that disguise, that like persona, that mask, is empowering. You can go out and do things that you wouldn't typically do or talk to people you typically shy away from. You can be something new, you can be something, you can be your own creation. And that's what I love about it. See, that's one of the busks I did.
Oh, that's neat. Is this the one that you were making for you?
Yeah, all for myself.
I mean, I knew from since Blake was basically a toddler that he was gay, so I just always tried to make it an environment that he'd be safe and happy in. To me, you're born a certain way and it doesn't make any difference. I mean, I truly believe that we are who we are. Blake has been Blake since he was born. He's had a couple rough patches with his dad's side of the family not accepting him, and I know it hurts him.
I never had come out to them as being gay, but you know that they know. Like otherwise there would be really no reason for them to have said the things that they had said. I remember there were several times when my great aunt had said, if you ever become gay, I won't hesitate to kill you or like track you down and kill you on the spot. And me being like a 11 or 12 year old hearing that, like what was that supposed to make me feel? Like I'm definitely grateful that I do have a place now living solely with my mom, that I can have my own drag closet or have my sewing projects out on the table or be able to rhinestone things or get ready in the bathroom here instead of having to sneak out and get ready at a friend's house to go to the club that I'm performing at. Like I'm grateful to not have to hide who I am anymore.
Family ties aren't the only relationships impacted by the lifestyle. Many impersonators say their female alter egos have destroyed their dating lives.
We have a thing in Sydney called the drag curse, which is kind of like I guess it's a sort of like tongue-in-cheek thing, but I guess it's kind of true, where men, gay men, aren't interested sexually in people who do drag.
For my ego, I like to think that because I'm a big star in Las Vegas, they're afraid to talk to me and that it's an intimidation thing, but I would guess it's more of a they're not secure in themselves thing.
There is a prejudice, certainly in the gay community, against people who are overly effeminate. I think it's a form of sexism. I'd argue that gay men are attracted to men and therefore aren't attracted to men who appear to be women.
When you see me, you see a whole gender change from my persona on stage. You see Larry, and then I go into this outrageous female face. The look changed, but I'm just the same person.
And when that guy comes up and talks to you, he's talking to your drag persona. He's not talking to the guy inside. You're talking to him, but you're not talking to him. So it's both a blessing and a curse.
Even so, the damage to their dating lives isn't enough to make them want to quit the craft.
I used to feel frustrated that Courtney was getting in the way of my relationships, but I don't anymore. Courtney is what I love doing. I love performing, I love entertaining.
If I was 17, I'd do it again. And knowing what happened still, I'd still do the drag. I'd rather heal people with the laughter now than with the medicine.
Drag is expensive. a lot of my money that I do make goes right back into drag. Drag is tiring. Drag is difficult. Putting on a whole new body, painting yourself a whole new face for it, it's tiring. It's a lot of work. But to do it and like go out there and creating your own fantasy is kind of what makes it all worth it. If I can go out and be something fantastic and be something amazing and something that people love, I'm gonna do it. It's almost therapeutic. That's just sort of my way to get what I'm feeling out to the surface. At the end of the day, I'm better than I was the day before.